Benevet de Lazare.
So the next presentation
is about
right. It's about efficient public key cryptography with bounded leakage and temporary resilience. This is by Antonio Faunio and from Aarhus University, Denmark, and Daniele Venturi from University of Trento, Italy. And the work would be presented by Antonio.
Hi, everyone. Thanks, Oliver. So this is probable secure cryptography before physical attack. Everything was very well shaped. So, can I just be loud?
If it's working.
Now?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Okay, probably security before physical attack, everything was very well defined. So there was a player P1, a player P2, they were interacting, doing some kind of cryptographic primitives, and there was the adversary could interact with player P1 and P2. There were very well defined way to define how the attacker was doing his attack. So he could corrupt P1, he could interact with P2, could see the transcript and so on. Nothing, how it was. Instead, with physical attacks, things really look more messy. As you can see now, there is no very well nicely shaped black box, but instead player P1 and player P2 will be implemented on very old and rusty computers. And these very old and rusty computers will make some noise, which more often will be correlated to the secret material that they use. So the adversary, which is smart, could leak this this information. And for example, there is the very famous timing attack of Kosher in the 96, which showed that you could infer some extra information and break the protocol. You could be even more smart. In fact, 1 year after, they showed that Bonnet et al. Showed that you can do some active attack. You can inject fault in the computation, and you can break cryptographic system. So the things here are much more messy than before. So we are interested mostly in tamper resilience. So let's give you some minimal related work. So when you want to do tamper resilience, the first thing that you want to think is which kind of tamper resilience you want to get on the circuitry of the cryptographic protocol, or the memory that contains the secret state. So in the case of circuit, there is this very famous work of Ishii et al. Then in the case of memory, there is this seminal work of Gennaro et al. Gennaro et al. Gave some impossibility result, but more importantly, they gave some impossibility result. The impossibility result say that if the adversary can tamper with an unrestricted way, in the sense that the tampering function is any polynomial bounded function, and it can tamper for an unbounded time of time, so we can apply many tampering functions, then there is no way to achieve many cryptographic tasks. So how to avoid this impossibility result? Let's consider the restricted sense. So you restrict the kind of function that can be applied on the secret state, and there is this work of Dzembowski et al. On non-malleable code, or for example, there is this work of Bellar and Kono on related K attack. So another way to avoid this impossibility result is to consider instead bounded amount of tampering. Here, the assumption is that you have this smart card, you are throwing a laser on this smart card, you do it once, you do it twice, at some point this smart card will just break down and you won't be able to do more than a bounded amount of tampering. So in this setting, there is this work of Damgaard, Faust, Mukeri, Venturi in 2013. They gave a definition of bounded tamper leakage resilience. They show an identification scheme and a signature scheme in the random oracle model. And also they propose a CCA secure public key encryption. Okay, so our contribution are two. The first contribution is a signature scheme in the standard model. Why we care about the standard model? Well, a part of it's always nice to have something in the standard model, but that's so because the impossibility result of Gennaro et al. Does not hold in the random oracle model, which means that somehow the random oracle model methodology in this setting is not very sound. The second contribution instead is a CCA public key encryption. So the public key encryption of the paper of Damgaard et al. Was based on Naor-Young, which means that it wasn't very efficient. You had to use very inefficient zero-knowledge proof, non-interactive zero-knowledge proof. So we just thought, can we do it with Kramer-Shoup? Kramer-Shoup is much more efficient. And the answer, of course, is yes. So for matter of time, I'm going to present you only the CCA public key encryption. So this is CCA public key encryption generically. So you have this adversary. The adversary can interact with our oracle. This is a decryption oracle. So the adversary can go to the oracle and ask for ciphertext, and we receive the message back. At some point, the adversary output two messages, M0, M1. The challenger chooses a bit and encrypts one of the two messages. And the goal of the adversary is to understand which message was encrypted. So now we want to enhance this setting to a more general setting of tamper and leakage resilience. So what we do is that we give to the adversary much more powerful by giving him some extra oracle. So the first oracle that we give is a leakage oracle, which means that the adversary can leak some information about the secret key. And then we say to the adversary that the adversary can instantiate up to T decryption oracle, which we will call tampered decryption oracle. Basically, the adversary can go to the challenger with a tampering function. The challenger will apply the tampering function on the secret key, and he will instantiate a new decryption oracle with this tampered secret key. Another adversary can talk for an unbounded amount of time with this tampered decryption oracle. There is something that we need to notice. So the first thing is that both the leakage and the instantiation of the challenge need to be done before you see the challenge. The instantiation of the tampering oracle, sorry, need to be done before you see the challenge. This is because otherwise there is an impossibility result. Basically, if you can leak one bit, you can always break CCA security. And leakage and tampering at least allow you to leak this one bit, the chosen bit. Then another thing that is important to notice is that, as you can see here, let me use the laser. Here, the adversary gets some public parameter from the sky. And this public parameter, we assume that they are tamper-free. So you cannot tamper with this public parameter. The idea is that this public parameter are going to be completely independent from the secret key. So you first set the public parameter, and then you pick your secret key. And the idea, this public parameter generally should be, you know, the description of the group, the description of an hash function, something that we fix there once. And the thing is that we need this thing, otherwise it's very hard to make construction in general. This is not an assumption that only us need, and it seems very hard otherwise to do cryptography without. Okay, so we wanted, when we started with this project, we wanted to do CCA security. We wanted to do this Kramer-Shoup kind of paradigm. We knew that we needed to have some leakage resilience because tamper resilience itself is a form of leakage resilience. So we went to the literature to see the literature, which was the most efficient public key encryption scheme out there, which was also leakage resilient. It used Kramer-Shoup. It happened to be this work of Qi and Lin, 2013 in AsiaCrypt. So what are the building block? The first building block, of course, is an hash-proof system, since it uses a Kramer-Shoup paradigm. And we already saw in the last talk what is an hash-proof system, but let me recall you. So an hash-proof system is made by a projective hash function, a keyed hash function, which is projective in the sense that you can define a public key given the secret key. And thanks to this, this hash function can be evaluated in two ways. The first way is like the secret way, which can evaluate the hash function in all the domain. Otherwise, you can evaluate the hash function in a public way to using the projective key. And the thing is that you can evaluate the hash function in the public way only for a subset of the domain, which is we will call the set of the valid ciphertext for the hash proof system. And the idea is that since it's a proof system, it's complete in the sense that if you evaluate it with if you take a valid ciphertext and you evaluate it either in the public way or in the secret way, you will get the same hashed value. And it's sound. So as you can see, there are many ways to define soundness. We hoped for this definition that used the mean entropy because it's the one that you know somehow it's much better with the leakage resilient setting. Here the idea is that outside of the valid ciphertext, if you take a ciphertext, an invalid ciphertext, and you use the hash function, the key that you will get is something which looks really really random. What I mean with that is that even given the projective key, the mean entropy of the hashed key for a ciphertext which is outside of the valid is an invalid ciphertext will have enough mean entropy. The amount of mean entropy will be minus log epsilon. Of course, the smaller epsilon it is, the better it is for us. And then there is the last property of an hash proof system, which is called that it has to have a set membership problem. Basically, it's hard to distinguish when an element belongs here or here. Then the second building block is an extractor. So an extractor is a function that takes a source and takes a seed and output a string. And the idea is that when the source has enough mean entropy, in the sense that since here we are in the setting of leakage resilience, the best way to define the mean entropy of a source is to think of a source which might be, you know, like a uniformly random string, but then you can get some side channel information about this string, and you want that even given this side channel information, you have at least enough mean entropy, so you have, you know, like delta mean entropy. And if this hypothesis is satisfied, then the output of the extractor will look like a uniformly random string, even given all the side information, including the seed. Then the third building block is a one-time lossy filter. A lossy filter is a keyed function which has as a domain a tag domain, a domain X, and a codomain Y. And the idea is that you have two different ways to sample tag. So there is a red way to sample a tag. And now if you fix this tag, this function that goes from X to Y is an injective function. Then there is another way to sample tags, which is the blue way. And in this setting, instead, the function will be non-injective. So what we want to have from this one-time lossy filter is that, first of all, it's lossy in the sense that in the blue way, then given a point in the image, the pre-image of this point it will be a set which is pretty big. It has at least 2 to the L different point for a parameter L for the lossy filter. The second property that you want is that there is indistinguishability between the tags. So it is indistinguishable to see if a tag is blue or is a tag is red. This is implied that, in particular, this lossy filter is a trapdoor function. And actually, the structure of the tag is a kind of particular structure. So the first part, so that you can divide the tag in two pieces. The first tag is like the auxiliary part, which is just a string. You can imagine a string of some size. And then there is like the core part, which is the important part of the tag. Then there is the third property that this lossy filter have is called the evasiveness, and this is probably the most interesting property that they have. The idea is that I give to you a lossy tag, and now you need to produce another lossy tag. And an adversary that doesn't know the trapdoor shouldn't be able to do that. So it's hard to find a lost attack, even given another lost attack. OK, so now let's give the construction. So the construction basically works as follows. So you have this ciphertext C. So the first thing that you do is that this is a ciphertext C for the hashproof system. The first thing that you do is that you hash the ciphertext using this hashproof system, and then you get this key. Now this key will have some mean entropy. So what we do, we extract all the mean entropy, and we get a uniformly random pad. Now we use this uniformly random pad to pad the message in a one-time fashion, and we get this phi. That's phi. Now we take all this part of the ciphertext, and this will make the first part of the tag. In this way, we kind of bind together the two parts of the ciphertext. Then we can sample a tag, which will be an injective tag, and we can instantiate the lossy filter. Now we take the key and we pass the key through the lossy filter. The idea is that since this thing is injective, and since this thing is trapdoor, this element phi will be a kind of pi, will be an authenticator, some form of authentication of our key. Okay. So how to decrypt? Well, the obvious way, instead of using the public evaluation, we use the secret evaluation of the hash. You get the key, you can extract the message. Now, before opening the message, we output the message if only if you take the key and you hash it through the, you pass it through the lossy filter, you get the value pi. So as you can see, this is like I'm authenticating this ciphertext using this pi. Why this thing is secure? Well, you can show very easily that the CPA is secure. So for CPA security, if you consider only this part of the ciphertext, basically what you get is the construction of Naur and Segev. The idea is that we are really using the fact that the soundness of the hashproof system is a statistical soundness. So during the reduction, the ciphertext C will be chosen to be invalid. So since it's invalid, what happens here is that this key will have a lot of mean entropy, even given the public key. Well, there is some leakage because, you know, we are considering leakage resilience. But if we set the parameter correctly, then even given leakage, this keys, we still have some non-trivial mean entropy. Therefore, we can extract this mean entropy and get a uniformly random path. Queen and Liu show that so that the scheme is CCA. Basically, the idea is that all the ciphertext made by the adversary will be injective, so the authentication will work as it's supposed to be. But for the challenge, we will set the lossy filter to work in the lossy mode. In this way, the amount of information of K that will be lost will be not so much. So we will lose a factor L bits of information about the key. And therefore, if the extractor is good enough, and this thing will be, this mean entropy will be enough to extract a uniformly random path. And then again, we have security. So the only thing that we needed to manage is how to get tamper resilience. So to get tamper resilience, basically we use this idea, which is recurrent in a lot of work on tamper resilience, starting from the work of Vishai et al., that tampering can be reduced to some form of leakage. Maybe you cannot do it in a black box way, but somehow a tampering is a form of leakage. So we want to simulate the decryption oracle, or the tampered decryption oracles, meaning the decryption oracle instantiated with this tampered secret key. The idea is to come out with a new oracle, which we need to define in our simulation, which behave more or less like the decryption oracle. But in order to do that, we necessarily need to leak some information about the secret key. This is because otherwise we will go against the impossibility result. So the idea is that if we can minimize the amount of leakage of from the that we need to simulate this oracle, then we will get a lot of we can instantiate a lot of tampering oracle. So the key point here is that while the decryption oracle can give an abundant amount of information, abundant amount of bits about the secret key, we want to restrict the amount of information that it can possibly give. So if we can find such a kind of thing, then a decryption oracle cannot give more information than the size of the auxiliary information that we use to simulate it. So let's try to do that. So one nice thing to notice about the scheme of Queen and Liu is that the only key material is the hashproof system. So the only thing that we need to protect against tampering is the hashproof system itself. All of the other things are some publicly evaluable functions. So, okay, this is a good observation. So we have this tampered secret key. So now we want somehow to simulate this decryption oracle. How can we do? So let's try to leak the projective key associated to this tampered secret key. So remember that the ciphertext is of this form, but the most important part of this ciphertext is the ciphertext of the hashproof system C. So there are two cases. So the ciphertext is a valid ciphertext. Then, at least in an information theoretical sense, the tuple C projective key of the tampered secret key fully define the key itself. So now, if we can like brute force the key itself, then we can execute the decryption oracle as it is. This is good. So this is the easy part. Then the hard part is when the ciphertext is an invalid ciphertext. Now, the projective key doesn't tell you anything about the ciphertext. So what can we do? Well, here the idea is that we try to use the same analysis that was used by Kramer-Shoup to prove CCA security. Basically, the idea is that we analyze this value. So this is the mean entropy of the hashed key for an invalid ciphertext given the view of the adversary. Then there are two cases. If this mean entropy is a lot, so this value is big, then this thing will behave. This key will be kind of pretty random, so it will be very hard to guess the authenticator, and so the most probable answer is bot. So the simulation will just say bot. Then there is the other case that can happen is that this mean entropy is small, and the idea here is that if the hashed value as low mean entropy, then since this is a function of the tampered secret key, we can prove that also the tampered secret key has low mean entropy, which means that gives very low information about the. Oh, okay, thanks. Yeah, very small information about the secret key, the original secret key itself. So you know what? It doesn't tell you about. It doesn't tell you a lot about the secret key. So just let's leak it, all of it. So basically, now we can leak the tampered secret key itself. And once we have this tampered secret key, then we can simulate the tampering oracle, kind of straightforwardly. So, yeah. But what do big and small even mean? So this is basically the hard part of like the technical part of this proof is try to understand what small and big mean. I don't have a lot of time here to tell you about, so I'll just say you a couple of words about. So basically, during the simulation, we set a threshold, and this threshold will go down, up and down, dependently on how the adversary behaves. So we follow the adversary during his attack, and we will set what big and small will mean. Well, as I told you, I don't have enough time to tell you about. Actually, I did, but I don't have the slide. So after some, some step of mathematics, what you get is that, as I told you, the important part of this encryption scheme is that it rely on the hashproof system that it use. We can show that we can find some, for some parameters of the hashproof system, which we will call alpha and beta, we can have a low a number of possible tampering oracle, which is equal to alpha plus beta, well, S, which is the size of the secret key, divided by alpha plus beta. So what is this alpha and beta? Alpha is the size of the projection key of the hashproof system, and beta is the difference between the size of the secret key and the amount of mean entropy that the hashed key has in the case of invalid ciphertext. So say that in another way, we need to pay alpha plus beta bits of leakage for each tampering oracle that we want to instantiate. Actually, we had kind of hard time to find a hashproof system that had this value. So as you can see, this value need to be very small. We had a hard time to find a hashproof system that had this property. So we found eventually a hashproof system based on the refined subgroup indistinguishability assumption. So there are a couple of open problems. First problem is that so the tampering rate that we get, meaning this, the number of tampering that we can do divided by the size of the secret key, is 1 over k, where k is the security parameter. While we don't know if this thing is inherent of our strategy or if we can get it better. And another thing which would be very interesting to see if we can find better hashproof system, better, you know, assumption, faster, whatever. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. So we have almost no time for a short question or comment. All right. Thank the speaker again.